Okay, good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We have received apologies from Liz Smith and Michelle Thompson, who cannot attend today's meeting. Jamie Halcrow-Johnson is attending as Liz's substitute. I therefore welcome Jamie to the meeting and invite him to declare any relevant interests. Morning, Jamie.
Morning. Thanks very much, convener. I don't think it's really anything particularly relevant. I'm a partner in a farming business and I own shares in TechGen and in Standard Life, but I'm not sure they're relevant to discussions, but there we are.
Thank you very much for that. With regard to our second item, we continue our inquiry into effective Scottish Government decision-making, and today we'll take evidence from two panels of witnesses. For the first session, we'll hear from Alex Thomas, Programme Director at the Institute of Government, and Dr Helen Foster, Ulster University. I welcome you both to the meeting and I intend to allow up to 75 minutes for this session. And we will move straight to questions. And the first is from me. So I'll open up with some and then colleagues around the table will contribute subsequently. So in relation to the Tolley inquiry into the former Prime Minister, the Sunday Times editorial 2 days ago said, and I quote, "The civil service is one of the great institutions of state. Its effectiveness rests on its neutrality. That's now in question and reflects badly on ministers as well as officials. Civil servants must provide candid advice without fear of reprisal, but ministers must be able to demand professionalism and results from their officials without fear of a grievance claim." Now, this was obviously referring to Westminster, but is it the same here?
I should assume if that's directed at me, I don't know, is the honest answer, which is not the best opening answer to a committee like this. I should say my expertise is in Westminster and UK level civil service, so I'm very happy to speak to the Tolley inquiry and the Raab affair. I would say that it is, you know, that editorial that you quoted is absolutely right, that an impartial civil service able to speak without fear or favour to ministers is very necessary to good government. And also ministers should be able to demand high standards of their officials. I think it's unfortunate in the debate around the fallout from the Raab affair that has sort of turned into a debate about the civil service, about the impartiality of the civil service. I think if you read the Tolley report, it's a pretty thorough piece of work. It goes through, you know, it's definitely written by a lawyer. It goes through in fairly, clear and, to my mind, fair detail around the circumstances in the Ministry of Justice, the Foreign Office, the Department for Exiting the European Union. It finds a couple of specific occasions where Mr. Raab, in Mr. Tolley's view, was intimidating, because of the test that Mr. Raab had set himself, he resigned. I personally actually don't think that speaks to a wider problem in the UK civil service or part of the civil service that that serves ministers in Scotland. Clearly, like any large institution, there are officials who are not as good at their jobs as there might be. There is a need across all of the different parts of the civil service to improve the skills, the project management, perhaps to tackle occasionally a culture of risk aversion, to improve policy making, civil servants to have more background in data and deeper expertise and so on, some of the things that we might get into over the course of the rest of this session. But I don't think there is some sort of conspiracy to thwart ministers in either the UK civil service or the civil service in Scotland.
Thank you for that. And I should have said Deputy Prime Minister instead of Prime Minister there. Dr Foster, is there anything you want to add on that?
No, I think my research principally looks at Public Accounts Committee and public accountability. And from my interviews that I have done, it's obvious that personalities play a very, very big part. That is officials and politicians. I think, as Alex said, this is just a reflection of a particular set of circumstances. It is not an indicator of wider problems.
Now, one of the things you've actually mentioned, actually, Dr. Foster, in your submission is the churn, which you said, churn among civil servants is an issue across the civil service in both Whitehall and across the devolved administrations, which is encouraged for the development of generalist civil servants, and researchers have also commented adversely about churn among politicians. And I had a wee look, and apparently in the year to September 22, the UK government had 5 education secretaries, and from 2000 to 22, 22 housing ministers. Here at Holyrood, we have had 4 transport ministers in 2 years. So how much does the churn in ministers as well as civil servants mitigate against good decision-making?
Oh, absolutely. Because each minister that comes in will have their own set of priorities. They may be looking at a wider framework that has been set out by Cabinet, but you know, everyone has their own little emphasis, I suppose. The minister is as important. You know, it's a two-way street. It's the minister and the official working together. If you have a large number of ministers looking after a portfolio over a short period of time, it means that they also have to get to grips with their brief, not only the officials, but the ministers as well. They are not building up that expertise. I would also say that the figures that what I've looked at had been at very senior positions in the civil service, but I think the churn from interviews that I have done, the churn below that higher level is actually worse than the highest level. You know, there's a lot of churn at the middle ranking civil service as well.
I would entirely agree with that. I think it's a problem in the civil service. I think it's a problem among ministers. We did some research, produced a graphic a few years ago that I'm happy to share with the committee, that compared the tenure of UK government ministers fairly unfavourably with that of football managers. So, there is a real problem there. I think I would always argue that Prime Ministers, First Ministers should do what they can to maintain ministers in post for as long as possible. You know, it's definitely not a good thing for the delivery and execution of government priorities for ministers to turn around. I would highlight, though, that the problem is perhaps particularly acute in the civil service if civil servants are spinning around too much, because we rely on the civil service to provide that continuity. One of the benefits of an impartial civil service that stays in office across administrations is that it develops that deep expertise. The legitimacy of the civil service relies on its expertise and its ability to serve successive governments, successive ministers. So while I absolutely think there is a problem with ministers moving around too rapidly, I would say that there is something particular to focus on in the civil service. Around making sure that that officials stay in post so that they can support whichever minister is in office to take the best decisions.
I mean, the kind of structure of the civil servants at Whitehall, and much of course the civil service structure we have here, is more or less based on that. It's been in position since 1854, when generalism was seen as the be-all and end-all. But, I mean, we're now in a much more sophisticated, high-tech kind of society, and we have a lot of differences over the generations. I mean, for example, contracts, procurement, etc., is complex and needs specialist skills. Are we in a situation now whereby we cannot deliver government without an increase in specialism? The generalism idea just won't cut it anymore.
I think you need both. If you look back to the 19th century and the sort of foundation of the quote-unquote modern civil service, there was an assumption about generalism, but actually, even then, that was mostly about rooting out the second and third sons of minor gentry who were looking for an easy life in the civil service. So even then, it was actually about recruitment on merit and about getting people with the right skills. And to some extent, that the context changes, but that that desire, that need to get people with the best possible skills into those jobs retains. It is one of the slightly depressing things when you work on civil service and government reform, that you look at Northcote Trevelyan in the 19th century, you then look at Fulton Report, which was in the 60s, you look at some of the debates in the 1990s, you look at Blair and then Francis Maude, and the same themes around skills keep coming up time after time. I do think, though, you hit on an important point, certainly the UK civil service at a kind of UK level, but I think the same is true in Scotland, has made fairly strong efforts over the last 10, 15 years or so to professionalise what it calls its functions, so the commercial and procurement function, the finance function, audit, digital and data, importantly. Those are still, they don't have a high enough status in the civil service, but they're getting there. They're at what slightly euphemistically referred to as different levels of maturity, which basically means how good and well established they are. And you'd say that some are more mature than others, and actually some became more mature, like digital in 2010 to 2015, and then perhaps slightly fell back a bit. So those functions do exist. It's got better than it was in 2010, 2005, but there's still quite a long way to go. I would make a very brief kind of word in favour of the generalist. It is important in government that ministers have people who can synthesise advice, who can fix things, who can act as translators of their policy objectives into the department. But of all of the things to worry about in the civil service, it's not the fixers and the generalists I would be worrying about, who have an important role. It's the people with the deeper technical skills, as your question implied.
Okay, thank you for that. And I mean, I don't think anyone would want to replace generalists in entirety. It's also about the balance, isn't it, Dr. Foster? And I think there's a concern that there isn't that. And also that people, when they develop a level of expertise, then in order to get promoted, get transferred into other areas of the civil service, and that skill is kind of lost. Also, I think there's an issue about how some of these specialisms are valued. I read in The Economist a few weeks ago that I think the head of cybersecurity at Westminster's salary was advertised at somewhere in the region of less than £56,000 a year, which in that kind of area is not going to attract, I would have thought, top-notch recruits. No harm to whoever gets the job in the end. So where do you feel this balance should be struck, Dr. Foster, between specialists and generalists if we are to get optimum decision-making?
It's hard to know the exact balance. To wait for this to go to pink or to green. Right, okay. It's hard to know exactly where the balance should be, but I agree there's always room for the generalist. The skill that I would say was lacking from the reading and so on that I have done is project management. It seems to be a particular area that would be particularly important here. And I know from being a member of staff at a business school that, in fact, project management, even trying to get somebody to deliver project management, to deliver a course in it, is very, very difficult. There are skills that are very in demand. And as you say, sometimes we are, both as universities and governments, are hindered, really, in who we can attract. Because if you are competing with the likes of the major professional services companies that are going to offer X times what you can offer in salary, that's going to be an issue. I think the finance has actually increased. That specialism has improved over the years. There are far more many fully qualified accountants now, in the civil service than would have been the case, a number of years ago. But there are other areas where those specialisms haven't been developed to the same extent that they should have been.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that was mentioned by former senior civil servants was they were of the view that there should be a separation between policy development and implementation. That wasn't shared, incidentally, by former ministers we spoke to, which I think is quite interesting. So where do you think that kind of boundary
if you're looking at policy development and then policy implementation, when I was looking at failures that had gone before, the audit office had reported on, invariably there seemed to be, this is policy, this is implementation. We don't look at policy, we look at implementation. There's a blurred line. Sometimes it's very easy, it's very defined, but usually it's messier. I think one of the other submissions talked about messy. This is a very messy business. It doesn't follow the nice little diagrams that we draw. So I think you need some people who are there from the beginning right through, but then you need people coming in and out really to add value as you go through the whole process. If that answers that.
Yeah, I'm pretty sceptical about too much separation between policy and delivery, not least because I think for the last 20 years or so, longer actually, there has been a sense that policy and delivery are separate, and the government has been struggling, all governments have been struggling to rebind them together. I think one of the things that the civil service needs to get better at is building genuine multidisciplinary teams that see projects all the way through from policy development to implementation. That doesn't mean, as Dr. Foster said, that the cast can't change a little bit and you might need lots more project management and implementation skills towards the end of the project and less at the start. But I think actually having continuity of civil servants involved in these projects is really important. I also think there's something about there's an assumption often that those teams need to be led by the policy wonk or the generalist. Sometimes that's correct, but it goes to your point, Mr. Gibson, that in order to rise up the civil service, you tend to develop those generalist skills and those leadership skills. It's quite hard. You're much more likely to hit a career buffer if you're a project management specialist and you want to stay in that. Again, a bit less so now than 10, 15 years ago, but I still think it's a problem. And I think the people who really get to the top of the civil service are those people who can work well with ministers, have those generalist kind of courtier-style skills. And I think we need to be much better at having multidisciplinary teams that are genuinely led by the person with the right skills to implement that policy.
And there should be ownership of policy right through from, you know, the conception to delivery and post-legislative scrutiny. Of course, that relies on ministers being in post, of course, as we touched on earlier on. Now, one of the things that I've been very curious about in terms of the evidence sessions that we've taken, and we've taken them from former ministers, former senior civil servants, from civil servants and academics, there's been absolutely no mention whatsoever from anyone of special advisers. And these, of course, are ill-defined and appear to have no specific job description. They've been around for, 45, 50 years, and, of course, they're endemic in both Whitehall and here in the Scottish Parliament. Boris Johnson at 126 on an average salary of 102,000. Holyrood were 17 last autumn on an average salary of 92,000, incidentally, and now there are 12, I understand. So what's their relationship like with civil servants and how do they fit into ministerial decision-making? Dr. Foster?
I think this is a particular... The growth of the special advisor has been a particular problem as regards accountability, because it doesn't fit neatly into... the paradigm we have, which is, ministers are responsible to Parliament, politicians are responsible to the electorate at the end of the day, and then there are procedures in place for the official, for the civil service. They can be called before the audit committee, or they are answerable. And it is much more blurred whenever the special advisor is involved. And obviously, the special advisor is a political appointee; it's not impartial like the civil servant. So that is a whole area, I think, that needs to be more needs to be looked at in much more detail. I don't know if that's something that this committee can look at, or it's a problem throughout the devolved administrations. It's not just Whitehall or here. If we had a government in Northern Ireland, we'd have the same problems. We still have SPADs.
Yes, I think I agree on the accountability point, and I think there have been some very high-profile examples of special advisers that, rather than exceeded their remit, have been allowed by their ministerial principal to exceed their remit. So I think some of the things that Dominic Cummings, for example, said about, I appointed or I dismissed a cabinet secretary, or, I forced out a chancellor, poses real and quite profound problems for accountability, as Dr. Foster said. Why did he do that, though? It was because the Prime Minister at the time let him. So I think it does come back to ministers, prime ministers, about how far they allow the writ of special advisers to run. And in the end, the accountability sits with the minister. I do think that we can get distracted a little bit by those very high-profile examples. And in my experience and in our research, the vast majority of relationships between civil servants and special advisers are actually very, very good. I would have no problem with more special advisers if prime ministers were willing to take the heat, or first ministers willing to take the heat, being appointed, because I think a good special adviser and a good civil servant, firstly, get on very well and recognise their complementary roles, and secondly, a good special advisor can amplify the voice, the views of a minister in a way that a very time poor minister can never do. So actually, very, you know, close working relationships between a special advisor and those civil servants in the private office, those senior civil servants in the department that are trying to get stuff done, can be really, really good. And a good special advisor who can synthesize the politics, the policy, the media, is absolutely worth their weight in gold.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's interesting. Well, they all also share the fate of their ministers often as well. So if the minister does well, they do well. And if not, they don't do particularly well, although they're not always tied to them in that way. But, I mean, they try and help the ministers obviously formulate and deliver policy. So I can understand your view there. But it does benefit the governing party, and it is politicised. So I'm just wondering whether they have an impact on the access of ministers whether they have an impact on the access of civil servants to ministers. So they kind of a Martin Bormann type character who stands at the door and prevents access from others, even senior civil servants, getting to the minister when perhaps they need to. Dr. Foster.
I suppose, again, that's down to the politician, as Alex has said. You know, is the politician prepared to actually tell the SPAD, you know, you're stepping out of line here? You know, that may be the case in some circumstances, but you know, both the civil servant and the politician, all parties have a part to play. They all must take responsibility. So if as Alex said, if the special advisor is exceeding their power and is holding back access, that is something that needs to be addressed by the politician.
Okay.
Sorry,
before you come in there, you did touch on workload earlier on. And obviously, ministers can have a dozen meetings a day. They've got to respond to questions in the chamber. They've got to formulate policy. They speak in debate. They're often pressed to deliver statements, or indeed they're proactive in terms of that. And they may have a constituency. They probably have a home and family life. How do they actually manage to balance effective decision-making with these other pressures?
I think it's really, really hard for ministers, and I think it is one of the problems in the system that that we put too much pressure on ministers to take those decisions. On the special advisor access point, it can be a problem, but it's fairly rare because, again, in most Westminster government departments, there are only two special advisors, sometimes three or four. That's still very small in relation to the number of civil servants. It's quite rare for SPADs to block access. They might pick favourites a bit, work out who they think is good in the department and who they think isn't so good, and use that to regulate access. One of the things that I think is important, there was an experiment in Westminster called Extended Ministerial Offices, which was about giving ministers more kind of personal support and more people they could personally appoint, not necessarily political appointments. But I was worried a little bit about that might mean the minister floating off a bit, if you like, being kind of in a bubble and insulated from what was actually going on in the department and what civil servants were doing to deliver it. So too much kind of insulation around a minister, I think, can become a problem. On your workload point, I think that's right, and I think that is there are in Westminster, certainly there are secretaries of state who can be entirely overwhelmed by the workload because they're trying to run these huge government departments. There are junior ministers who can sometimes feel a bit underemployed, and actually some of it does come back to a Secretary of State who's prepared to delegate, who's prepared to set clear priorities. But I do also think there is a role for ministers being perhaps a bit clearer with civil servants where their powers of delegation lie as well, to clear some of the clutter off ministers' desks so they can focus on what's really important.
Okay, and Dr. Foster, does this mean because of the workload of ministers not being able to have their eye constantly on the ball all the time, does this have an impact on the quality of decisions? And does it mean that some of the decisions are effectively being outsourced because they're having to rely on other people effectively to have a full grasp of the details, so to speak?
I suppose down the years, the politicians I have interviewed would all say that they're busy. They're very busy people. People sitting on this committee, I've interviewed committee members before, maybe people sitting on a few different committees, constituency, a couple of hundred miles away, etc., have lots and lots of commitments. And I'm sure that is even more exaggerated for a minister, will have additional responsibilities. However, it is a matter, as Alex said, of prioritising, you know, what is important. And I suppose sometimes there is a tendency to try and do too much or even to focus on too many different policies. You know, they feel that they have to do lots and lots of things, particularly if they think they might only be in office for a short time. You have to get all of these through without thinking them through, taking a very short-term approach. But again, it's down to prioritisation. What can I do? You know, we go in the morning, you've got X, Y, and Z, but which is the most important? You know, and what is, I suppose, what does the particular government want to focus on? There is at the end of the day, the minister makes the decision, and the civil servants or whatever advise. Consultants are sometimes used, and there was a big piece of work a number of years ago by all of the auditors of by the National Audit Office and the devolved audit offices on the use of consultants. I'm not convinced that the consultants were, you know, giving necessarily the best advice at enormous expense. There was actually a case of a report coming in one particular case, and the consultants hadn't even changed the name. They'd actually reused something, and it hadn't been proofread properly.
But of course, consultants are hired because there isn't the specialist capacity within departments often. I mean, that's why they're obviously.
Yes, but
in.
I think the use of consultants would need to be weighed up very, very carefully. You know, are we using it as just a way of passing the buck, rather than taking, you know, both the civil servants and the politicians have to own the decisions that are made. They can't really be outsourced.
But I mean, lastly, you've got a 24-hour news cycle of pressure for ministers to make announcements. You know, they want to be seen to be successful. They're in their own political party as well as the wider public. And if only get the life expectancy of a Hibs or a Chelsea manager, you can understand that they want to make an impact right away. So, I mean, it all comes back to the same thing about it really in terms of churn and stability within the civil service ministerial relationship, doesn't it, in terms of being able to develop long-term significant outcomes? Because we have a situation where ministers often come up with these wonderful ideas which may not be wonderful in terms of implementation. They've long since moved on by the time the ideas are actually implemented.
Yes, I think, sorry. The other issue is that, you can measure the outputs fairly quickly. Did we employ more people or whatever? But it's the outcomes, the longer-term outcomes, they're not likely to be seen for, you know, 5-10 years down the line. There's not an emphasis on that, you know, because you measure, speaking within the country, you measure, you know, what you can measure easily. That's necessarily what you should be measuring. And as you say, the people have moved on. There's always an emphasis. I mean, I suppose the press, in particular, want to do the sexy bit. You know, the ministers want to do the sexy bit, announcing the policy rather than the drudgery of seeing the whole thing through. Again, going back to sort of failures, you know, that came before audit committees and public accounts committees, it seemed to be that second bit that was really missing. They wanted to do the sexy bit.
I agree with what Helen was saying there, but I do think there's, not to be too kind of council despair about it, absolutely stand by everything we were saying earlier around the kind of the churn of ministers and civil servants. I do think there is a danger, and this goes back a little bit too to the Dominic Raab debate, of assuming these are two antagonistic tribes, and the civil servants are saying go slow and this is, you know, very risky, and ministers are saying I don't have much time and I need to respond to the demands of the media. Both of those pressures are true, and civil servants will tend to be more risk-averse. They will tend to point out the financial, legal, practical obstacles. But that can be a creative tension as well. And I think one of the things for an incoming government or a sort of government that wants to refresh itself or incoming minister to think about is how do I work really constructively with my civil servants, but not just take everything they say at face value or dismiss everything they say. How do I get under the bonnet of the advice that they're giving me so that I can form my own view about whether they're being too risk-averse, whether we should take this financial risk, what the risk is of something getting gummed up in the courts or whatever. And I think the really good ministers give civil servants a hearing but are very kind of active in forming their own view about whether they believe civil servants' advice. You know, some of the best ministers I've worked with, regardless of political party, were very open to that, had their own strong views, but sort of recognised the different players' role in the process. And I think the best civil servants do exactly the same.
Yeah, a lot of that's come through strongly in evidence. I'm going to open up the session now. Daniel, to be followed by John.
Thank you very much, Convener. And in a sense, I want to carry on in terms of the line of questioning that the Convener was asking regarding generalism. Before I do, can I just thank you both for, first of all, name-checking the Fulton Report, which is something I've done in the past, because I think it's interesting how frequently these themes come around, and also project management. Because I think, Dr. Foster, you set out key stages of decision-making, of being problem identification, agenda setting, consideration of potential actions, implementation and evaluation, which I think is really good framework. But what has struck me when we've been sitting down discussing this, whether with former ministers, civil servants, or indeed outside, the tendency is to always dwell on policy. And actually, our inquiry is about decision making in the round. We're not being prescriptive. If we push, they might talk about implementation. If we push a bit further, they might talk about finance, but really only at prodding. And they certainly, I think it's only, if we ask very specifically, if things like kind of commercial considerations, and given the amount, the number of external contracts and relationships government now has, it's not that the state does everything, it contracts out a lot, that's quite odd. And in a private sector organisation, that commercial function becomes key. So when we're talking about generalism, is it that actually not so much generalism, but that we overemphasise that policy, that those early points, as those first two bullet points in Dr. Foster's, to the almost the exclusion, and it actually is about rebalance. It's not so much about generalism in terms of an area, but actually we need a bit more focus on those different stages of the life cycle and having specialist skills within them. Would that be a fair summary?
I think that is fair enough, yes. This identification of the problem, then the agenda setting, the consideration of all the potential actions, and also I think I noted, I certainly have read that the issue of non-action, you know, so there's always an option not to do anything. What are the consequences of that going to be? Which is perhaps, you know, everybody wants to do something rather than maybe just consider that the status quo might be okay. The implementation then and the evaluation also, it should be a loop. I tried to upload a little circle, but I wasn't very good at trying to upload this onto your, I should have done it as a PDF and then attached it. But it should be a virtuous circle. You know, when you have you look at what's happened before, you have implementation issues, which, you know, didn't work out. That should inform the agenda setting and the policy. You know, so there should be learning as we go through that. And I am not convinced that that happens. You know, that these lessons are not learned. So we reinvent the policy and we make the same mistakes again.
I mean Alex, I'd wonder if you'd agree, but then I just sort of add the extra. You were discussing some length about not throwing out the generalism. I wonder if the question is actually how that generalism is actually acquired. So if you look at other organisations, typically you would be drawn into a particular function. And when you hit a certain level, you've sort of developed expertise in an early career, you then start hopping. So you'd see people who have come up through a finance function or an engineering function or a sales function. And it's only once they hit sort of their mid to senior career that they maybe start broadening out their skills. Is there a need to sort of, not throughout generalism, but think about when we seek civil servants to acquire that generalism?
Yes, and I think There are the specific skills that you need in order to do a finance job or a commercial job or a digital data job. I would make something of a distinction, though, between those quote-unquote policy skills. So we quite often ally the sort of policy civil servant with the generalist civil servant. And I think one of the gaps that the civil service does have is deeper specialist expertise. Now, I don't think that civil servants should, you know, stay in the same job or stay in the same narrow field, kind of going up for the whole of their careers. But I do think the way I talk about it is have more of a career policy anchor. So you have those, you know, commercial, financial, you know, functional experts who are part of the multidisciplinary team, but within each broad policy area, so, you know, education policy or social policy, or you have people who are much more consciously anchored to a particular policy specialism, so that over the course of their career, they're not very narrow, but they are they're developing a kind of broad understanding of how government works in their sphere, but they're anchored to something more than they might otherwise have been. I always felt, I mean, I worked in DEFRA a bit, I worked in other government departments, but I always felt anchored to the kind of how of government worked. I worked on constitution, I worked on electoral systems, I worked in private offices. I was a sort of, you know, boiler room, a mechanics of government type person, and I felt that was my career anchor. And I think civil servants should be thinking that way, so they can bring that to the party as part of those multidisciplinary teams I was talking about earlier.
Following on from that, one of the other points that has been made by separate groups of people is that there is a lack of consistency in terms of the approach to both policy making and implementation across different portfolios. And bear in mind, in the Scottish Government, we don't have multiple departments. It's essentially a single government department, which is, in a sense, quite surprising. You might expect that in Whitehall, but not the Scottish Government. I wonder whether you would both agree that therein lies a bit of, you know, the problem. If you don't have those consistent approaches to both policy development and implementation, that you will always struggle.
Well, I suppose it's not a case of one size fits all, which I think I said somewhere as well. Sometimes, you know, that you can have a framework, but the framework needs to be moulded for particular circumstances of a particular function or a particular area, and also, I suppose, it's also moulded to a certain extent to reflect the particular personalities that are involved. I mean, you have the framework, but it's how you interpret that. It's very dependent on the people that are involved.
I should say, as you will probably be aware, in Westminster, we quite often looked with envy at the coherence and consistency of the Scottish Government because of that sort of one department. It might not feel like it here, but it felt more coherent looking from London. But two quick points on that. One, I think, and it's a really difficult and complicated balance subject, but who should be accountable, or how should civil servants be accountable for that consistency of application and of skill? And my view has, I've come to the view that we don't get the accountability arrangements quite right, and civil servants should be more directly accountable, whether to Parliament or through some other means, for the consistency of certain functions of government. And I would include contingency planning in that, some aspects of, you know, project management or commercial skills. And it's really hard because that butts up against ministerial accountability. And I think there's a very delicate balance, but I think there's an important and interesting question about how we more directly hold the civil service to account for the skills that it develops and the consistency of those skills. I think there's a second point also about the sort of the public scrutiny of that, but that may be something we come on to. I do think there's a bit of a risk, and looking through some of the evidence that you've received, you know, wiring diagrams and everything, that we focus a lot on the process, on the policy cycle or a policy and implementation cycle. I think the other thing that the civil service and ministers need to really think about is just having the right people with the right skills in the right place, because government is always going to be messy, as Dr. Foster said. It's always going to be, you know, an incoherent. You're always going to have to react to the demands of a media cycle. And it's pretty rare that you get, it does happen, but it's pretty rare that in government you get the opportunity to sit down and map out a policy cycle and say, OK, we've got 5 years to deliver this, here's how we're going to do it. It's much more common to have the right people, you know, reacting in the right way to develop and implement a policy.
Yeah, I mean, I guess my only sort of slight counterpoint to that is that that sort of assumes that everything in the private sector is neat and orderly and predictable, and it's not. And yet, actually, I think if you look at successful kind of large organisations, they will have a lot more kind of consistency and a standardised methodologies. And I agree they need to be adapted. But I think there are, I think we need to be careful about kind of exceptionalism for decision making in government.
I would entirely acknowledge that. I mean, I do think I sometimes get twitchy about sort of too much kind of reading across between private and public sectors because the pressures are different. But I do think, particularly in these areas we're talking about, commercial finance data, there is nothing magic about public sector or nothing magic about government, which is why I come to the how do you hold the civil service more directly to account for the consistency of these standards. Also, another thing we've written about quite a lot, the IFG, how does the centre of government set those standards in a way that doesn't undermine an individual minister delivering their policy and being accountable to Parliament for doing it, but does set some kind of basic standard of how government should work. In Westminster, the Cabinet Office, I think, is far too weak in doing that. It's become a very kind of strange department, and there is much more space for a smaller, in some respects more contained, but much stronger and authoritative centre precisely to set those standards that you say. You've got me on a hobby horse now, though, so I should get off it.
No, it's an interesting one, and Michael Barber's book, Instruction to Deliver, sits on my bookshelf. But so it's one sort of final question, and I'm interested by the IFG's proposal that there should be a kind of a new civil service bill clarifying the role. And I wonder if there's sort of a, more than just function, we also need to think about the structure. One of the things that strikes me in the Scottish government is that you don't have direct mapping at the director general level to cabinet secretary. And then actually when you look below that at director level, some directors will actually feed into multiple ministers and cabinet secretaries as well. Now, I'm not arguing that you need a direct one-to-one, but you do need, I think, some sort of thing about the wiring diagrams. You don't want too many connections. And I think critically at cabinet level, if you don't have that kind of clear line of accountability and delivery into there's an issue. Is there a need to think about that in the Scottish Government? And are there examples in Whitehall of good and bad? Because I'm guessing the different departments look quite different in terms of how they manage those relationships between kind of civil service roles and ministerial roles. I don't know.
I'm conscious I'm giving quite long answers, so I'll try to be brief. I mean, I quite like the way Francis Maude, actually, Lord Maude, talks about this on his reflections from his time doing civil service reform, about sort of tight and loose. And so there are certain things, if you think about, I mean, Whitehall suffers from, benefits from, this acute tension between the vertical, the departmental structures, and the horizontal, which is the functions and the cross-cutting skills and sort of support teams, if you like. Francis Maude's view, with which I agree, is that there are certain things the centre should hold tightly, like finance standards, for example, and those should be applied consistently across government. And then there are other things that are loose, like policy development and to some extent implementation, which should be held in the vertical hierarchies of the department and for which Secretaries of State should be accountable to Parliament for delivering. But I think you have to recognise there is a tension there, and there's a tension over accountabilities, and there's a tension over, you know, particularly budgets and who sets the money and the role of the Treasury in it all. But I think there is something in that model about having really, I mean, to your point about clarity, clear vertical hierarchies, but also everybody being clear on what those horizontals are as well. I think, you know, better or worse practice, I think it is hard in Whitehall to disentangle the overall sort of complexities and problems with the department that might be in, you know, not in a particularly good way, like I'd say perhaps the Home Office is at the moment, with the challenges of its policy agenda and broader kind of cultural questions about the wiring diagrams. But I do think, you know, you look at the Cabinet Office, it's pretty messy at the moment. There's lots of, you know, lots of very senior people all trying to kind of carve out their role. There's been a profusion of second permanent secretaries in Whitehall, which I think to some extent relieves the burden on permanent secretaries, which is obviously a difficult and overloaded job, but also confuses accountabilities and so on. So I definitely lean towards having the kind of clearer accountability lines. I don't know fully whether that's answered your question, but
Dr. Foster, do you have anything to sort of add?
No, I don't really have anything to add to that. Sorry, in Northern Ireland, well, we obviously don't have an assembly at the moment, but we are very much the functional, the traditional department. We don't have the structure that you have here.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Daniel. John, to be followed by Ross.
Thanks so much, convener. Dr. Foster, in your paper, I was interested in one or two points you made that were interesting. And one was around the area of public engagement and consultation. And you seem to suggest that actually the Scottish Parliament government does consult quite a lot. But then you make the comment, or you quote somebody else making the comment, that media attention may be a stronger driver in Scotland than the majority of government agendas in other countries. I wondered...
That was a quote for someone else, yes. Okay. It was an observation.
Well, you can tell me if you agree or disagree.
I'm looking at... maybe it's... the media is particularly strong in Scotland. Certainly when I looked at... when I was looking at the public accounts committees and audit committees as... trying to ensure that there was accountability. And I actually did do a paper, and we looked at the media coverage throughout the devolved administrations. And certainly the media would seem to be quite strong in Scotland, perhaps compared to... One of the quotes I got was that the media, for instance, in Wales was quite weak. Okay. But looking sort of more generally, we have in Northern Ireland, we have this phone-in programme in the morning called Nolan, and ministers and officials don't want to appear and don't want to be quoted on Nolan because it's just... when something is picked up by that media, it's very, very difficult, perhaps, in some cases, for the government have to react to it. You know, they can't just... Because it just snowballs, you know. And his first comment was, well, I spoke to the department and nobody was available, you know. And then the next morning he comes in and we still have not received anybody. And this goes on for a week, you know. And, you know, so it can have an adverse effect, maybe. Getting back to the media, you do consult, you do have these... lots of consultation, but sometimes I think you have open calls, but you end up then resulting in the same people responding all the time. Do you consult with people who are like favoured? Do you consult with people who are going to give you a particular answer? That's not talking about Scotland in particular, but just generally. Mm. I mean, even when it comes to appointing consultants, as we talk about consultants, do you appoint consultants that are going to give you a particular answer because that's what they come up with, because that's what you want? So I think we need to be very, very aware of that. The other thing is then, are you consulting them for the purposes of saying, ticking a box, we have consulted? Or are you consulting... because they are really going to be a driver of the policy. And certainly, the literature would suggest that actually that's something that Scotland has done very well in. They've actually taken consultations more to heart maybe than elsewhere.
And would it be fair then to say that we're making better decisions because of that consultation, or does that not
necessarily... Not necessarily, The other thing is that, you end up then perhaps with parochialism. So, in the Northern Ireland context, I can know about the health service, people don't want their local hospital closed. But in fact, for the bigger health picture, we don't have the specialisms there, and we need to close them, and we need to reconfigure it. If you consult with that local constituency, they are not going to say, close my local hospital. Mm-hmm. So there's a fear, I know you're all politicians, and I know somebody was quoted on this, a member of the Northern Ireland Assembly when we had a sitting one, was met on the steps of Stormont one day, and he had sat on a committee, and he said, I'm away off to the constituency, there are no votes here. Okay, so you have to remember who you're, even though he performed very well in committee. you know, that wasn't actually what was going to get him elected again, you know.
Okay. Mr. Thomas, do you want to come in on that?
Only that I find it depressingly hard to link improved processes of consultation and engagement with better outcomes, as Helen Dr. Foster was just saying. I do think, I mean, just reflecting all of that, exactly the same at the kind of Westminster world, I think the more reactive a government gets, the worse its decisions would tend to be. Not always, by any means, and sometimes there's, you know, sometimes clearly decisions need to be made in a crisis. But when I think across my experience and our research, the mistakes that tended to be made, the legislation that tended to be botched, tended to be that had been introduced in a hurry and often in response to a specific kind of crisis. You know, something must be done, this is something, rather than more thought through. I think the value of consultation and process in getting to better decisions is often less about the engagement with individual kind of communities, but more about the how of the process, letting some air in, giving some time, more time to reflect, allowing people to be more bound into a process that they can sign up to, rather than getting to the kind of sharp edge of better decision making.
Okay. And then maybe following on from that, the whole question of short-term decision-making against long-term, and we took evidence from New Zealand, where the suggestion was that the civil servants have a requirement, I think it may be a statutory requirement, to kind of produce some long-term options, not to give advice, but just to give these long-term options to try and get a more long-term view. And I think, again, Dr. Foster, you mentioned short-termism in your paper. Should we be more long-term in our thinking, or how do we make better long-term decisions?
This is a perpetual problem, you know, having it's gone on forever. Obviously, you know, the politicians are here, you know, until the next mandate. So you want to achieve things in that time frame. But I think there needs to be a more sort of overarching, longer-term view taken. And in particular, sometimes decisions are taken or policies are developed which will actually hinder, perhaps, you know, an improvement in the future. You know, they answer a particular problem at a particular point in time, but they are actually going to impede then maybe something else happening in the future. And that's joined up, you know, so you can take shorter-term decisions which are part of a longer-term strategy, if you like. I know it's difficult, and I don't have the answer. I wouldn't be job if I had the answer.
Yes, just to clarify that, I mean, would that be like, you know, putting more money into, say, accident emergency instead of preventative healthcare or something?
Yes, dilemma. Yes. It's always the reactive versus the proactive.
Right.
Yeah, the prevention.
Covering the two great problems of decision making in government, one short term, long term, and the other cross departmental, cross boundary decision making. On the long term point, I think it is very difficult, and ultimately, democracy is the worst system apart from all the others. So you know, the failures of the political cycle are outweighed by the many other benefits of it in terms of accountability and responsiveness and so on. My answer, and it's not a perfect one, it relates to what I was talking about in response to Mr. Johnson's questions about accountability and the kind of some of the responsibilities that should rest with the civil service. I strongly believe the civil service must remain under ministerial control, and that policy decisions need to rest with ministers. But I do think there is scope for Parliament, whether it's Westminster or the Scottish Parliament, any other, more explicitly giving the civil service responsibility for certain things, like, for example, contingency planning. And I think that would help permanent secretaries and other senior civil servants feel the heat a bit more on those kind of capacity, capability of the state type questions that absolutely shouldn't prohibit Parliament then taking that away again or changing it, or, you know, the civil service needs to remain under democratic control. But I think saying, permanent secretary, you have a responsibility for maintaining a capability in your department up to this particular level on these particular issues, would overall help public administration, but also help ministers know that there's a kind of base level of competence and capability in the department as they go about pursuing their other policy priorities. But it's not a perfect answer by any means.
And does that need legislation to do that?
I think in my view it would have. I mean, you could set out the aspiration, but I think given the tendency of the system to sort of revert to the norm, legislation would underpin it. And secondly, the fact that I am defensive when I talk about this and acutely alive to the sort of anti-democratic argument, kind of perma-state argument there, I think it would be important if any role like that were to be taken on by a bureaucracy that it was under a kind of parliamentary mandate and parliamentary control.
Okay. And the other area I wanted to touch on was the question of transparency. I mean, generally speaking, we think of transparency as being a good thing, but we have had it suggested to us by, I think, former civil servants that too much transparency, you know, means that civil servants and ministers cannot be as frank with each other as might be beneficial. How do we get that balance right, do you think?
I suppose, well, you can have, as I quoted in my paper to you, you know, when we had the Rand Docs, it was Northern Ireland, but it was to do with the award of the contract in Westminster, and then we had the renewable heat issue in Northern Ireland. You know, it came to light when we had a full inquiry that, you know, meetings were held and there were no minutes, you know, which was an issue. So I think it needs to be recorded, but not necessarily all the detail needs to be recorded. So it's not a verbatim account of what has happened, but it is, you know, who was there, what decision was made, and that is recorded. Transparency, I mean, I could go back to, you know, civil servants, you know, they would say that, wouldn't they? You know, I know that the Freedom of Information Act has actually been used as a reason for not recording in some cases. Certainly, that came out in the renewable heat inquiry in Northern Ireland. That, you know, if it wasn't recorded, then it couldn't be reported.
It's a truism, but transparency seems like a very good thing when you're out of government, not such a good thing when you're in it, and vice versa. So I think you absolutely must preserve the private space for ministers, officials, others to take decisions, to maybe, you know, say silly things and then realise they're silly. Mm-hmm. But I do think, maybe this is because I'm now out of government, I think we need to shift the dial more towards at least the underpinning evidence being more publicly available. I mean, impact assessments, certainly in Westminster, pretty shoddy quite often, and a more thorough public presentation of underpinning evidence, I think, would work. I do also think that there, again, I would shift the dial a little bit on the provision of advice to ministers. I absolutely wouldn't release, you know, submissions that go direct to ministers, you know, in public within you know, a few days, weeks or months. But I would, it comes back to the accountability theme that I keep coming back to, again, for civil servants just to feel that bit more kind of accountable for the advice that they're giving to ministers than they currently do, because it can disappear a little bit into a black hole. And so something more that could be published after a reasonable period that doesn't get into the specific conversations between civil servants and ministers, but sets out more on what basis the decision was taken, would, yes, I think, be a good thing. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Ross, to be followed by Douglas.
Thanks, Kavir. Alex, I'm particularly interested in this suggestion from the Institute for Government around a new statutory duty for the civil service to serve the public interest as well as the government at the time, and exactly that point you just made of countering the anti-democratic deep state argument around this. And you said that the key there would be parliamentary accountability. So what it sounds like is you're essentially saying that the civil service should both serve government and serve the public through Parliament, which leads to the question of what would the civil service be doing for and at the behest of Parliament that government wouldn't be asking of them?
I would take a slightly narrower view. So my answer to the question relies on taking a slightly narrower view of the civil service working to the public interest. So I don't think the civil service, it's this sort of impartial but not independent thing that is going around at the moment, partly following the RAB controversy. I don't think the civil service should be, or civil servants should be, saying, I have some duty to the public interest, therefore, you know, minister, you can't do X, Y, or Z. I think civil servants should be saying, I've got a duty to good financial management, to the law, to ministers. And that's why I frame it as a duty to government capability. So I think there is something that Parliament can and should hold civil servants more directly to account for than it currently does around the capability of the state. So the areas in which I would give the civil service that responsibility are absolutely not in policy areas. They are in the kind of, you know, under the bonnet, if you like. So I mentioned contingency planning, but I also think, and we touched on it earlier, capability around finance management, financial management, around project management, procurement, contract letting. I think those areas for which we could reasonably expect the civil service to have the professional skills to support ministers, we should open the box on that a little bit. So that's the link, I think, that could go into Parliament through a public accounts committee or a committee like this or whatever.
Thanks. And just come back to one of John's latter points there around transparency. I'll set the scene with an example. You might have seen a couple of months ago now there was a suggestion that was set a leak from a private conversation, senior NHS officials suggesting that maybe to ease the pressure on the health service, we essentially needed a two-tier service with the wealthiest people paying for it, so it would no longer be free at the point of use for some people. The then health secretary, now first minister, obviously had to immediately come out and say, not a chance of that happening, not under this government, etc. But there's, you know, a strong line of argument there to say, given the pressure on the health service, senior officials should feel free in a private space at least to come up with whatever idea they want, as long as there's sufficient accountability and ultimately it's for ministers to decide. And in that case, that idea obviously should never have flown. Your argument around transparency, from understanding from both of you, is that obviously final whatever decision has been made needs to be correctly minuted and documented. The evidence base for that needs to be presented, but that we shouldn't necessarily compel the civil service or government to publish what the alternative options were in each particular case. Every idea that's floated shouldn't necessarily make its way into the public domain, because that would have a chilling effect. Is that a correct paraphrasing of your positions, or is there a level of transparency that's required around alternative proposals to whatever one the government eventually lands on?
I think, yes, basically. I think a reasonable position to end up in would be that the decision that is, you know, the course that is settled on is more fully justified and evidenced, and all of the different options, because precisely for the reasons that, you know, we're all, you know, realistic enough to know that the media and campaigners and others will take controversial things in controversial directions, and that's, you know, that's fine, and that is as it is. So I think you just need to, it's a balance, isn't it? So that's a long way of saying yes.
Dr. Foster, again going back to a point that John came up on earlier, in your written evidence you made the point that the Scottish Parliament is generally well regarded for public engagement. The flip side of that, and a point of criticism that's often levied both at ourselves and at the Scottish Government, is the length of time it takes to make any particular decision or to deliver any particular policy in Scotland. You know, any piece of legislation is going to go through multiple consultations at government level. It will then obviously have to go through parliamentary consultation before it's considered by committee. That's not to mention co-design processes that are becoming more popular for very good reason. But these all cumulatively in all sorts of areas of public policy are leading to a lot of frustration about the length of time it takes to deliver issues, deliver on issues that are not even vaguely politically contentious, issues that there's complete consensus in Parliament on, but it still takes us years longer than the public would want or that we would want to deliver on, in part, not entirely, but in part because of the consultation-itis is what it's been referred to before. How do we wrestle with that tension between thorough public engagement, which by necessity takes time, and delivering policies on the timescale that the public would expect of us and that we would want to be delivering them on?
I suppose there's always a tension there, but just because policy takes a long time to develop doesn't necessarily mean that it's right. I'm not totally familiar with the amount of consultation the consultation that you do here, except that I know there's a lot of it. So perhaps the consultation could happen with shorter time spans. So you put a call out and you say, right, if you are going to comment, it's a very, very, you know, short period of time. I'm sorry, I really don't have the answer, but I think something must be, you know, if you say that generally the politicians are not happy, the public are not happy, that everything's taking so long to develop, particularly where it's non-contentious, I think there must be some way of addressing that. I don't know if you've got anything to add, Alex?
Only to say that I suppose part of the answer, I agree with all of that, part of the answer is, and I think you've heard evidence on this before, but showing people what the consultation is doing. Yes, kind of keeping it rapid, keeping it pacey. But Polly McKenzie, who used to work at Demos, writes interestingly, I think, about the value of the process. In highly contested areas or areas where there is no, you know, no perfect outcome, one of the values that government can bring or parliamentary debate can bring is bringing people into a process. So if people are properly engaged in a process, they'll be less frustrated by the time it takes to get there, I suppose.
Thanks, Roch. That's all from me, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Douglas.
Thank you, Convener. I had a question around the recording of decisions being made by ministers. It's maybe a question for you, Alex, from your experience. Is there a robust process or system in place for ministers that maybe give approval for something, for that to be kept and then maybe looked at later to check, you know, who did approve a certain thing?
In theory, I think, again, speaking to my Westminster experience and Whitehall experience, there are times when it's broken down in practice. I think there's a long-term trend around data recording and emails, WhatsApps, and so on that means that we're about to hit, when we get to the kind of, you know, 20-year rule, 25, 30-year rule, we're about to hit a period where the records get much patchier and much less coherent and comprehensive because of technology. I also think there are periods when we saw in moments of deep crisis, notably the pandemic, decision-making around contract awards and, recording of decisions around contract awards broke down. It's also distressingly common for, you know, now in my kind of current perch at the Institute for Government to get a phone call from a journalist saying, you know, we've been asking the department about X, Y, or Z, and they've said that there's no record of it. You know, should this have been recorded? And my answer is normally, yeah, actually, probably should have done at least an email from a private secretary saying the minister's considered this and it's happened. I think the biggest decisions, the most profound decisions, The central decisions do tend to be properly recorded. I think looking at the evidence in the Grenfell inquiry, I think what's likely to come out in the COVID inquiry will show that the kind of often those bigger or longer term things were probably, you know, submission went up, minister considered it, a decision came out, properly recorded. I think there's a whole sort of miasma of other things that are not so well recorded. And I think, you know, more discipline around and more clarity of decision points, because not everything in government absolutely should be recorded. And some of the debates around WhatsApps has got a little bit over the top. But clarity about points of decision, who was involved in that, and then how that goes into the official record is definitely something to improve.
Because that's something we've experienced in the Scottish Parliament around the ferries, you might have seen, you know, where there was a decision made about a 90 million spend at the time, it's up to about $250 million now, and there was emails being frantically searched for to find out exactly who gave the approval. And for me, I just think that's wrong, that, you know, we're trying to hunt about in, you know, email archives to try and find out who actually gave the decision. Surely there must be a better way of recording it, or maybe there is, but it just hasn't been followed. And trying to work out which one it is.
It's the difference between, you know, the policy and what happens on the ground, you know, all of the devolved administrations, we could come up with examples of this is what should happen and this is actually what happened, or this is what was recorded, as I say, you know, famously, the renewable heat in Northern Ireland. Mm-hmm. You know, these meetings happening in no minutes.
And government by WhatsApp is not, you know, not likely to be good government, because you're likely to miss out key people who should be involved in decisions. You won't necessarily record those decisions. You won't have all the evidence in front of you. As a value, you know, why do we look at COBRA and the contingency planning architecture? That's, again, there's no magic to that. That's just about getting the right people in the room, putting a bit of thought into it in advance, having a proper agenda, working through, recording a decision and transmitting it. There is value in those kind of slightly pompous, old-fashioned meeting, minuting, submission writing and decision making on the basis of that. I think I think all governments need to just keep an eye on the WhatsApps and not go too far down that road.
Yeah, I think that's something we've discussed as a committee before, government by WhatsApp. Other question I had was around review, and in terms of policy decisions made, do you feel there's a proper review process to look back in years to come, whether that was the right decision to be made or what we could have done differently and trying to learn from that to go
yes.
forward?
Yes, well, I did talk about me trying to put in the little circle, the diagram. Their institutional learning throughout all of the administrations in the UK is, I would say, fairly poor. We don't learn from the mistakes that we make. And, the auditors will tell you when they go back, 10 years after looking at a particular area, they'll see the same issues coming up again and again and again. I've lost my train of thought there. When I start talking about audit, I get very excited. Sorry, what was your question again? It was about the...
It was just about...
When the policy is developed in the first place, that's when the how it's going to be evaluated needs to be built in. Hmm. It's not looking, 5 years down the line, we look at, and then you discover that you don't have the data to actually, to do that evaluation. So evaluation is actually something I think that we're fairly poor at, generally. But that needs to be built in right from the start, because it's better to collect the data and maybe not use it than to have the data available to you, and then you can mould it in whatever way that's appropriate. But the evaluation piece, I think, is something that needs to be improved on and can be improved on.
Completely agree on that. I think lack of evaluation is a huge problem. It's often claimed that's because ministers aren't interested in evaluation or it's politically embarrassing or whatever. I'm sure there's an element of that. Actually, in my experience, it's as or more often because the caravan's just moved on. There's no resource. Everybody's now focused on the next shiny thing. We think quite a lot about, as Helen said, about how on earth to try and build in evaluation at the start of the process. Do you demand an allocation of 2% of the budget must go on allocation on evaluation, and you try and build that in at the start, so you have to spend that towards the end on evaluation? Do you tee it up with parliamentary select committees to keep hammering away at it? But we do that already, kind of, and it doesn't really work. So I don't think there's an easy answer other than really kind of hammering away at these accountability lines, whether it's through parliamentary select committees, ministers holding officials to account, or trying to kind of, as Helen said, through every means possible, finance and procedural and potentially legal, build that in at the very beginning.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And I guess final point is, obviously, we've got the National Performance Framework in Scotland. Do you feel, or maybe you don't know, that the decisions we are government's taken are aligned properly with the MPF when they're making that decision right to start?
I'm sorry, I can't really speak to that.
It's beyond my knowledge. I would say I was civil servant in the coalition government in UK level 2010 to 2015. It really helped that government, whatever you think about the decisions it took, that it had a clear and politically very entrenched programme that was agreed right at the start, that everyone knew what was what. And so, perhaps reflecting that experience, one of my views is that any incoming government needs to invest political capital and time early doors to agree a programme and make sure that is well known across the government. And I think that would lead to more effective outcomes, even if occasionally be politically, presentationally awkward.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Camino.
Thanks very much. I think everyone in theory agrees with the National Performance Framework and the outcomes it tries to achieve, but sometimes people see that it contradicts some of the things that people want to make public announcements on. So, for example, it might contradict numbers. So one may say that, for example, we want to achieve a certain health outcome by reducing the number of beds, but then when it actually comes to reducing beds, it causes us a political kickback that was actually touched on earlier on. I mean, I just want to finish off with a couple of questions, but before I do that, I'm going to let Jamie in because I think he's got a couple of things he wants to.
Thanks very much, Camilla. Good morning. Very, very briefly, because I'm kind of conscious of time, and I'll put my kind of two questions into one. You talked about kind of people becoming, kind of having a generalised approach and rather than something specialised, and obviously a churn of civil servants, churn of politicians. I wondered how, actually, you know, what the concern is that individuals can be stuck in the same kind of position for too long and therefore not able, even if they're implementing other people's ideas, not able to come up with new approaches, certainly from the civil service side, and also longevity of government. We've got two parties that have been in government for a very long time, and how that might impact on the civil servants that are asked to deliver, whether there becomes an institutionalised approach or a general approach, whether that has an impact on how they're able to take decisions and respond to decisions.
On the jaded or institutionalised point, I do recognise that. I think there are civil servants who, whether through huge passion about a subject area or for other kind of career incentives, end up staying in one post or a very narrow range of posts for a long time, and that can lead to stale thinking, or actually more often of course that isn't going to work because we tried it 10 years ago, and sometimes they're right and sometimes they're wrong because the circumstances have changed. In fact, Helen and I were talking beforehand about the contrast between the civil service in Whitehall and the civil service in Northern Ireland, and I think they're polar opposites, actually. I think the Whitehall civil service, there are some people who develop deep expertise, but is basically spinning like a top. I think various kind of demographic and cycles of cuts and growth, Brexit, COVID, have led to the UK Whitehall civil service. The problem I would worry about there is very much not one of stale civil servants being stuck in a rut. I think in Northern Ireland, but Helen can speak to this much more authoritatively, the opposite problem is there. So it's a Goldilocks moment. Whether Scotland has got the Goldilocks quite right, I don't know. I sense, and from talking to people, that the Scotland neither suffers from the stuck in a rut nor quite the churn that Whitehall does. So there is there's hope there.
Okay. Obviously the civil service here is part of the Home Civil Service, whereas Northern Ireland, because of its history, has a completely separate civil service, because the foundation of the state, civil servants left Dublin and came to Belfast. So I suppose the history, we're all a product of our history, the history is very, very different. I think what Alex has said is true. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Just to wind up, a couple of questions from me. Consultation, I think we touched on when Ross was asking questions, but I think the issue really isn't about consultation. I think what people want to do is to feel that they are actually involved in the start, so it's really about participation. So, for example, the first major consultation I was involved in was 25 years ago when I was a councillor in Glasgow, and the local authority announced it was going to close 9 secondary schools of 38 in the city. And it named the 9, and then there was going to be a consultation on whether or not each of them would close. Remarkably, the 9 that they announced 6 months later were the 9 that actually they voted to close. So there was a huge kind of feeling that this was just a cynical manoeuvre, a box-ticking exercise. 25 years later, I think that's still a real concern. So surely when it comes to, we shouldn't really be talking so much about consultation, but people participating in policy development at an early stage, being consulted on what government is going to do, but allowing them then to participate in the development of that policy rather than saying, this is a policy, what do you think about it? And governments are going to come back most of the time and say, well, we're still going to plough ahead with perhaps only minor changes. Dr. Mm-hmm. Foster.
Yes, I think for those people who are involved, are participating or being consulted, regardless of their involvement, I think you need to justify, maybe what they want. You can't keep all of the people happy all of the time. But you need to, those people who have participated, certainly it's better to have them participating in the policy making rather than just being consulted as a tick box, as you say. But it is important that if the particular view that they are expressing is not seen to be taken on board, that is then explained to them, that they do actually get some feedback. It's not just a case of, no, we just missed what you said. Yeah.
I suppose the really cynical approach would be to announce a different 9 schools or 12 schools and then deliberately but know that they're not the ones that you're going to settle on. So there is a whole kind of the political art of consultation and participation is more of your expertise than ours. But I mean, I agree with you. I think it's participation, and I think as Helen said, it's the the leadership skill of explaining to people why decisions have been taken the way they have. Not everybody's going to be happy the whole time, of course. But in the context of this inquiry, the aim should be to take better decisions. So the kind of the ministers, civil servants don't have a monopoly of wisdom, and so the objective needs to be to hoover in information that enables you to take a better decision, and then, as Helen said, to play that back to those who've participated.
I mean, I think that phrase you just said, monopoly of wisdom, is interesting, because, I mean, what's interesting is we talked about the generalism versus specialism issue in terms of civil service. But, of course, ministers are almost all generalists. Some of them are appointed to ministerial portfolios that they have no understanding of, no real interest in before they're actually appointed to it, and may perhaps say they would have rather been offered something else completely. Now, that means they're obviously relying even more on special advisers and their civil servants. So given the fact that situation is unlikely to change and all governments are going to continue to promote generalists, how can we enhance decision-making within that context?
I think that's a great question and huge. It'll be here for the next 2 hours. But there's something for me about the kind of the craft of government. If you look at a government minister who's often held up as someone who has broadly made a success of those ministerial jobs he's taken, Michael Gove. Michael Gove is not an expert in environment or agriculture. I've worked with him a bit in DEFRA. He's not an expert in the justice system. But because he understood the levers of power, because he understood how to run a department, because he had the political authority to win fights with the Chancellor over budgets or et cetera, he was able to come into those departments and, okay, not every decision was the right one, I'm sure, but to assert himself on the department, take some time to work out what he thought his policy objectives would be, and then properly use the civil service, sometimes uncomfortably, I'd say, appointing people who permanent secretaries might not always have been happy with or whatever, but that discomfort is part of the kind of grit of government. But sometimes uncomfortable, but use the departments then to prosecute those objectives, whether you agreed with them or disagreed with them. So there's something for me about the craft of government, and it comes back to what we were saying earlier, the role of ministers in that, the role of civil servants in that, the role of civil society and the public in that.
Perhaps, and I always feel the need to hit the ground running.
Yeah.
I mean, the same would apply to when I interviewed people who sat on Audit or Public Accounts Committee. They said, "Oh, well, I'm not a specialist in finance." When I was put on this committee, etc. And some people wanted to be on there. And then I was speaking to someone else who actually said, "What we need is not necessarily going back to your talk about statehood, but statecraft. It's not necessarily members who are." Experts in finance, but experts who are people who are good at scrutiny and asking questions, not necessarily knowing the answers, but the same sort of the same applies really to ministers. There, it's knowing, as you say, that the architecture, etc., and the work around it, rather than the specifics.
Okay, I'll just ask our witnesses if they've any further points they want to add before we wind up the session. If there's anything you feel we perhaps should have touched on but didn't.
No, not for me.
Not for
thank
me
you
either.
For having us.
Exactly. Thank you.
Okay, well,
Great to be back in this lovely city.
No, great. And thank you very much for your contributions. They've been extremely helpful. And also I want to thank you for travelling to Scotland. Actually, I think it makes a huge difference to the quality of the evidence we take. It really does. And I say that to someone who's quite averse to virtual meetings in the first place, but also we've had some quite difficult situations in the committee in terms of all sorts of snarl-ups with that recently. So thank you very much for coming along.
Thank
it's
you.
Very much appreciated. I'm now going to call a 5-minute break while we change witnesses. Thank you. Okay then, folks, so we will now continue with our evidence taking on effective Scottish Government decision making. I'm delighted, therefore, to welcome to the meeting Paul Sheeran, Chief Executive Officer, and Rebecca Rigg, Commercial Director, Scottish Engineering, and Sandy Begbie, CBE, Chief Executive Officer, Scottish Financial Enterprise. And as members may recall, this evidence session is intended to focus not only on the witnesses' experience of Scottish Government decision making, but also provide an opportunity to explore how their sectors approach effective decision making. So we're going to move straight to questions. So with that in mind, the first thing I'm going to ask Paul is, how do you actually approach effective decision making?
In our sector?
Yes.
Wow. There's a question I didn't expect to start with.
It takes as much time as you need.
So, we are the engineering manufacturing sector, so yes. As you would expect, there's a fair chunk of logic in that. There'll be a spreadsheet or two that sits behind it, usually. But I do think that underlines it's quite a methodical, quite a logical process. I would say that a theme that I'm sure will come up today, it's generally pretty rapid. Is generally there are reasons why at times it will have constraints from a time point of view, particularly where the company is part of a larger group, perhaps part of an international group, and so there'll be constraints in terms of you'll get to a point where the decision is we want to do this, but it will need to be approved perhaps because there's some treasury or finance considerations that come with it. I think I'd like to say that generally the direction for our industry is that it is one where certainly the best examples in industry, the decision making is genuinely coming from across the entire company. So any company who have adopted lean principles will understand that the top of the company set the direction or the ultimate destination for the bus, but the people on the bus are the ones who decide how the bus is going to get there. And I think that one's direct across the board. There are times within that where the process has to kick in, from a logical process of financing, return on investment and so on, and those will be management decisions. But generally I would say where you're looking at the best practice in our industry, it comes from the team upwards in terms of what the road that's chosen to get to the point that's the destination.
Yeah, I mean, I think that first of all, I think that's an excellent answer in a very short time. I think you've really got it in a nutshell. I think the them and us approach that I think we had several decades ago has kind of dissipated. At least in companies that want to be successful, and I think people, all levels of a company realise they've got to push in the same direction. And I think if people are involved in that direction, I think it does help. I mean, I worked in a pharmaceutical company, and they basically had a staff suggestion scheme. And they asked us all to come up with ideas to improve how the company would actually deliver. And nobody submitted any ideas. And I suggested to my manager, who then passed it up line, that maybe if they gave people an incentive, actually, they would find that things would be different. And what happened was they then decided that members of staff could get up to 10% of any savings actually made by implementation of a policy. And the company was overwhelmed with suggestions about what improvements they could make. So I think having you probably heard me talk about participation versus consultation earlier on in terms of public sector. I think staff being able to participate in terms of their own company and suggest ideas that would be beneficial to them, directly, as well as in the long-term delivery of the company's objectives, is obviously helpful.
Yeah. I mean, I think a good example of that, I was out visiting a company yesterday who are one of, we have to be honest and say it's still in the minority, but it is a growing group of employee ownership companies. And that brings a whole different dynamic because literally everybody in the company has a stake in it, and they have a stake. And so they have a stronger voice in the decision making. They have a stronger voice in the direction. There still needs to be, to an extent, a command and control structure because, chaos would ensue otherwise. But I do think that's a direction of travel. But even in the privately owned, family owned companies where, as I say, go back to those that have adopted lean principles to thrive and survive, they don't work unless there's a genuine consultation. And essentially, I did hear at the end of that conversation. I remember hearing before a very old-fashioned way of defining consultation. Remember, consultation is not negotiation, but where people embrace consultation in its truest terms, which, as I heard, was before you've made your decision, then I think it is really effective. And I think there was another point that was made there in your last guest, which I heard as the consequences of a lack of diversity of thought. And I think that's, again, when organisations talk about when they get this right, is the diversity of thought of listening to everyone at every level of the organisation is what makes for really effective policy for companies in terms of what they're going to do to survive and thrive.
Yes, I mean, you do say that open-mindedness is one of the criteria in terms of behavioural decision making. I mean, Ochrani in my own constituency is owned by its employees, and it's got 170 workers, so it's not always small. People think sometimes it can be very small scale, mm-hmm. but it can actually be much larger and even encompass sectors that people don't automatically think of. Sandy.
I was just building some of Paul's points. I think in my experience around about that effective decision making, I think there's a strategy is key. I think that in the absence of having a well developed, tight strategy that articulates what the priorities are for the business, I think is where a lot of that can go wrong. As part of that, then you've got that sort of you've got this balance between the operational plan that underpins the strategy, but also obviously, the businesses that Paul's in and I've been in is that long-term investment. So you need to be able to invest long-term into the business in line with that strategy. The concern is you never make those longer-term decisions, and therefore you maintain in this operational cycle. I think the other thing that's important around decision-making is understanding actually what are the small number of measurements that you're actually going to outcomes you're going to achieve. So over-measurement can be an issue as well, so organisations can end up spiralling around trying to measure everything when actually strategically there's probably a very small number of things that you should be focusing on. And if you've got that framework, then decision-making then aligns behind that strategic framework. And then you, on the back of that, again, just echo one of Paul's points, then once you've got that a strategic alignment framework, then you can empower people to make those decisions down the organisation. You can engage them around the implementation of that. But then what underpins all of that happening is effective governance and making sure that the governance is appropriate. So that ranges from the normal things that people would associate with governance around, board committees, board structures, if required, divisional structures, etc. But also, I think it's around that diversity of thought, creating the right culture, the challenge, etc. And governance should enable, support, challenge, and oversee the delivery of that strategy. Again, only a couple of points I would add. One is that that leadership and tone from the top is hugely important. So people are empowered when they feel as though the tone from the top aligns with what they're being told. So quite often that inconsistency of leadership behaviour can disempower people. And I think the culture in the organisation needs to understand that if you're going to empower people, then not everything is going to go right all the time. So you need to be able to accept that there will be mistakes that are made. I think the strategy is about articulating the end point and then empowering, recognising that different people in different teams and different areas will move from where they are to where they need to get to in slightly different directions. So it's more about outcomes rather than sort of being directional around how to get there. So I think that's quite important about empowering people. If they agree with outcomes, then leave them to it.
Yeah, I think one of the things that's important there is leadership in terms of the private sector. People tend to have a strong knowledge of their company and, perhaps over many years. Yeah, I think one of the differences in the public sector, if you're a minister, for example, is you can be a minister for justice 1 week and then you could be minister for health the next week, if that's what the first minister or down south, the prime minister, decides to actually do. So there's a real difference here in terms of that. So how the ministers here then have to rely on the advice of civil servants, special advisers, etc. What kind of structure would a mean, obviously companies come in all different shapes and sizes and sectors, but what kind of a structure would a company, say a small to medium-sized company, which the majority of companies in Scotland expect to have, if any, Sandy?
I'm just clarifying, the question's around leadership and the movement of leadership and the transferability of leadership. I think then that's not uncommon necessarily in the private sector either. I mean, you know, the law organisations I've worked in, which granted are larger, but we would naturally move people into areas for which they may not have any necessarily great technical expertise, but actually they're doing it for the purposes of development. And in that case, then it's important to make sure that they've got the team around them who can provide that. So it's all about balance and setting people up for success. And I think that I think one of the most important behavioural traits in leaders in that position is about, sounds a bit of a cliche, but understand, knowing what they don't know, and the ability to ask questions. So just being honest, some of the best politicians I deal with, MSPs, understand what questions to ask because they won't necessarily know the answers. So when I engage with them around financial services, then that level of engagement and that two-way communication is really important. And I think that's a good trait in leaders. It's about being able to recognise that even though you're in the most senior position, actually you're not necessarily the most technically capable. And actually, in some ways, you shouldn't be because you're not there because of that. You're there because of your leadership capability. But therefore, it's about empowering people to make those decisions on your behalf.
Yeah, I mean, it seems to me ultimately, you know, in politics, when the challenge function goes, that's when you know that the politician is basically, you know, their time is coming up because they get to a stage where they think that they only want to surround themselves with people that agree with them, and then eventually, you know, they kind of hit the buffers. So I think what you've emphasised there in terms of challenge function is really important. I mean, Paul, what about the dichotomy between long-term and short-term? Now, in politics, obviously, the emphasis is on five-year cycles, perhaps even shorter if you're a new minister who wants to make an impact. But when I studied economics at university, I remember a lot of people just thought the companies were there to make a profit. But one of the first things we studied was the theory of the firm, which is whereby companies are trying to, it's about long-term survivability and growth rather than just making a quick buck this year or possibly next. So how do companies, generally speaking, and again, we know they're all different and, across a huge range of sectors, etc., but how do companies generally look if the economy is buoyant, for example, let's take that example, how do they decide on short-term versus long-term decision-making?
Okay, I'm going to come to that one. Can I add a comment to the transferability of skills? Again, I agree with Sandy. I mean, I would say, but you know, take that example of a minister who's going from justice to education. The political framework is the same, and so I would compare that in our sector of someone who has come from an engineering manufacturing background, but they've gone from electronics to sheet metal manufacturing or fabrication. And increasingly what we see there, it's about understanding or building a good culture, or preserving and maintaining or building a good culture. It's about behaviours, leadership behaviours. It's about the ability to analyse whether you know the subject or not, and so they're asking the what questions. And I think the last one there is, I think you touched on, is the lifelong learning. The leadership has to come with a aptitude and desire to be a consistent every day as a school day, because you don't know what you don't know. But if you are interested enough in it, you can get into it quickly enough that you're leadership skills can then allow you to differentiate and lead in that way from those behaviours, cultures, and analysis. To go to your question on short and long term loans, or what companies do in that situation. So I think you're right. You start by saying the only running a company, managing, leading a company is not something you do just to make a profit. That's important, because if you're not making a profit, you're not going to be a business that's going to be in business. So, but fundamentally, the best companies are the ones where people are building a community, where that community will morph and change, but has longevity. That is it. And so when you think about that, the challenge for the company comes is if you're in a time of crisis, then the leadership has to make decisions which are extremely rapid and less considered, because there simply isn't the time to make the consideration that you would, as opposed to the time, and Sandy rightly talked about the fundamental being on good strategy. So companies having good strategy, that is the responsibility of leadership. Having clear medium and long-term strategies is absolutely fundamental. And then good leadership is recognising when the situation in hand has to be adapted, changed rapidly to the situations in hand. And unfortunately, we've seen such a number of them in the last decade and a bit. COVID's been a great example, in terms of adapting. The impact of Russia's invasion of Ukraine on energy prices, adapting, changing to that. And some of those have meant that companies have had to say, do you know what, we have some long-term strategies which are still extremely relevant, but if we do not do this today, we will not survive. And therefore, they've had to pivot very quickly and change to make sure that they preserve the company. And at the heart of that, it's not just about profitability, that is about a company as a community, which has to be preserved at all costs.
And I think it's, in terms of behaviours, you were very straightforward. You talked about an open mind, genuine listening and a rational approach in there as well. Sandy?
Yeah, I mean, I think that balance of short term, I mean, to Paul's point, I mean, it's been tested to destruction in the last the last 2 or 3 years. But likewise, that business environment with that clear long-term strategy then, and in many cases, many businesses will still have faith in that strategy. Well, undoubtedly, will probably have gone through some refinement or at least a good thorough review at the board level. A lot of that will remain consistent. The thing I would add is there are huge differences in sectors, which I don't think should be underestimated here. I mean, you've got businesses like in the retail side who are hugely impacted by the economic cycle, massively impacted by things like COVID and other things. While in part of my career I spent in the energy sector, for example, I mean, you're making 40 to 50 year investment decisions, that's a much longer term business that, yes, granted, with the Russia Ukraine has probably experienced a challenge that it hasn't in the past. But in many ways, you're still making those long term investment decisions. And therefore, your business cycle is less volatile than, say, if you're in retail. And I'm kind of using them as two ends of the spectrum, and different sectors have different cycles in the middle of all that. But your strategy is the thing that hopefully will provide that consistent direction, but you always need to be alert to what's going on in the outside world and respond to it. And again, it's partly down to leadership and culture in the organisation and its ability to react, take on board and get the organisation to pivot or change in the short term in order to deal with these challenges. But very often the strategy will be that constant.
For me, the discussion has become so fascinating, I'm in danger of being drawn into it to the exclusion of my colleagues here, so I'm going to just actually touch on one other thing before I move on and let them in. And that's just in regard to your submission, Paul, you've basically, when asked about what does effective decision-making by the Scottish Government look like and how can we learn from what's worked well and not so well, you've said what worked well is the aerospace response group as a response to the significant pandemic impact on Scotland's aerospace centre. What has not worked well is reaction to the current skills crisis. So if you could possibly touch on why the aerospace response group worked so well and why the reaction to the current skills crisis did not.
Okay, I think, and this is a little bit selfish because I think it looks from our sector. So the aerospace response group, I think, was really appreciated because it mirrored the way industry works generally. We hit a crisis which hit everybody, but in our sector particularly, there was a very immediate impact for a sector, the aerospace sector, which we really value for Scotland. A huge value, high quality jobs, and there was a deep concern. And so I would say that the response, the rapid response, the collaboration to bring together the right people in the right room virtually, you know, to address that quickly and look at solutions-based discussions, interested in actions that can make a difference in the short term, in the medium term, and didn't jeopardise the long term, but really about looking at what's the situation in hand, how do you react to that, how do you get the right people around the right table. And I think it was remarkably successful. I think it's the outputs from it just now are still being appreciated in the sector. The sector has its own challenges, mostly with the other problem of growing, and you know, overall growth provides some challenges. So, but in terms of the groundwork that it laid, you know, I think it's a great example of moving at pace, rapid decision making, genuine still consultation, the truest meaning of the word, but action-orientated outputs, because that's what the situation required. So aerospace response group. And on the skills response side, I think I find that one much less successful, because I think the crisis, and we are in a crisis in skills in our sector, certainly, and I suspect in other sectors, has been arriving for some time. And there's a question, I suppose, the question we are asking ourselves in the sector is are we being unclear enough or unhelpful in the way we're articulating that, in the way that we are putting that out? And that's us trying really hard to put ourselves in the other set of shoes and ask, why are we not, why is this not being listened to and being reacted to? And so in terms of that size and scale of the challenge versus the size and scale of the opportunity which Scotland has, you know, principally in respect of climate emergency, the lack of response and the lack of timely intervention, the lack of concrete actions which will change that, feels disappointing in comparison to a good model, which was the aerospace response group.
Okay, maybe others will probe that. Sandy, do you want to say anything more before I move on to colleagues?
I mean, in addition to my role at SFE, I chair DYW, and I also authored the Young Persons Guarantee. And I would just, so I've had quite a lot of kind of engagement on the skills agenda for quite a number of years. It's just not fit for purpose, bluntly. It's slow. It's not aligned around the needs of the economy. Just about every meeting I have these days with businesses invariably comes back to skills, regardless of what the topic is. To Paul's point, if it's about growth or overseas markets or export opportunities, whatever, it comes back to the fact that we can't access the skills in order to maximise the opportunity. Mentioned climate change. Our own industry launched our own skills plan last April. 50,000 opportunities we're going to have over the next 3 years. Trying to get the further and higher education system to sort of understand that, align behind it. It's not because they don't want to do it, it's just that there's so many barriers to them trying to do it. There's the traditional ways of doing, I guess the traditional ways that colleges, universities and schools have done things in the past, is just not keeping up to pace with what industry needs, what the economy needs. And COVID has just shone a light on that, but it's been there for years before that. You know, there are endless number of examples of where our economy has been held back simply because we don't have the provision of skills.
Want to add anything at all?
No, I think I'm fine.
Okay, thank you. Right, we shall move on now to colleagues around the table. First will be John, to be followed by Daniel.
Hey, thanks very much, Convener. Previous sessions we've had, mainly with civil servants and people in government, there's been a lot of talk about transparency. And obviously, when they make decisions in the public sector, it's all subject to FOI and all that kind of thing. Whereas in the private sector, that wouldn't generally be the case. Do you think that leads to better decision-making in the private sector? Well, I'll go to Mr. Sheeran first.
Well,
no, on you go.
Does it lead to better decision? It could, you know. It shouldn't lead to, because that level of transparency. So, to your point, John, is I think transparency goes hand in hand with making good decisions. So if, right. if there is transparency around decision making, whether it's in the private or the public sector, that should give rise to improved decision making, where you are actually engaging a broader range of people in order to try and reach a better decision. The fact that it's a freedom of information request that might hang around and you might be called upon then, if you make the right decision, you feel as though you've made the right decision and you've taken on board people's comments and you've had a proper decision-making process and governance around it, that shouldn't in itself concern you if you feel as though you've reached the right decision for the right reasons.
Okay. I mean, within a business, financial sector or wherever, would it vary how much transparency there is within the business so that even if the outsiders don't know why decisions were made, at least everybody in the business would know why a decision had been made?
Yeah, and I think a lot of that comes down to governance. I think having clarity on where decisions are made, who's making those decisions, at what level, if required, what committee is that decision going to be made, then having the transparency. And a lot of that transparency comes around the data that goes into those committees in order to make those decisions. I've been fortunate to work for two organisations whose governance was really, really important and, you know, was very highly regarded externally as well. And therefore, I do think I've got a good understanding of what that looks like. And it's the transparency of not only decision-making, but the leading up to the decision-making. It's about the quality of what goes into making that decision. And then it's the quality of implementation at the end of it. So transparency throughout all that process is hugely, hugely important. And you can see lots of examples of where decisions have been made without that transparency on data and information, etc., which leads to bad decisions. And you can see it in the corporate world all the time. I mean, CBI is probably a good example.
Okay. Mr. Sheehan?
Yeah, I don't... It's hard. Good question to ask. I think I'd say that I don't think there is a difference between the racial quality of good decisions and not so good decisions with the private and in the public sector. But there are some key differences in the way it gets there. So I think one of the first things I would say is I suspect that every decision that's made, particularly from a Scottish Government point of view, if you had the time and patience, you could wade your way through the 70-page documents to understand it. Whereas in a company, in terms of where there's been known that there's a consideration to be had, the expectation from the employee group is that you will boil that decision down to a one-page slide. And so more people understand how that decision was made and therefore will be in a position to raise their hand at the town hall or at the employee representative group and say, hey, hang on a minute, but what about? Because it's easy to understand. So I would say, you know, you look at it from our point of view, one of our challenges is so some big impacting decisions are made. It's very difficult for us to get any company of less than probably 250, 300 people interested in understanding that to give us some feedback that we can be helpful, because the sheer size and scale and the weight of the information means you have to be a dedicated follower to kind of wade your way through that. That's not to say that I don't think that the understanding and decision making is in there. It's just not very accessible. So I would say a big difference between private sector and in this example government is there will be more people out there who understand that. And I think in terms of going back to that rapid, so companies will come forward and say, you know, coming up from a Kaizen event or a Lean Six Sigma event we had, we considered this, we challenged it, we've done this, this is it, and we think we're going to do this, we're going to invest in that, and da-da-da, there's our decision. And that will be explained at the town hall, and all employees will hear that because they'll run it through night shift, day shift, back shift, if they have shift systems, and everyone will have a chance to stick their hand up. Then on the other hand, then there'll be an employee representative group or a works council where their employee rep, if there's a question that people wanted to ask but they didn't feel comfortable, they can take it to there. So it's a much more direct relationship between boiling, distilling the information down as this is what we considered and this is the decision we made, and the ability to somebody to go, hang on a minute, I want to ask about that.
Okay. Does
that make sense?
Yes. You've mentioned speed a number of times.
Yes.
I mean, is that a strength of the private sector and a weakness of the public sector that you can make decisions quicker?
So I wouldn't pretend that I know enough about what you do and that to say that your decision making should be faster. Certainly our sector would love it to be, but whether that's a possibility with the constraints you have, I don't know that. It is definitely a delineation. Private sector knows that when you can, so we talk about rapid and considered decisions, rapid where the only thing you need to do now is make a decision. Because of the situation you're in or the triviality of the outcome, you need to make a decision. And there's only one other type of decision, and that's considered, where you have to pause, rapidly take input, consult, understand, hear different voices, and then back to the rapid, you make a decision and move.
Ms. Rigg, I don't want to put you in the spot, but I do realise you've not really said very much and so on. Are too many decisions made in business by men?
Oh, well, I'd like to think that that society's changing and that boardrooms are changing and decision-making's changing. And now that we work in an environment where women are considered when decisions are being made. So, but as Paul said earlier, I think it's about consulting everybody and having broad input to decision-making, which is important.
And do you think that is changing, both, I mean, from what you know of the public sector and the private sector, do you think we're moving in the right direction?
Yeah, I do.
Yes.
Slowly, but yeah.
Okay, thanks for that. I think it was yourself, Mr. Begbie, you talked about mistakes are made inevitably. Do you think the private sector handles that better than the public sector in learning from mistakes and so on?
Not necessarily. I think there's a lot comes down to company culture. So I've seen cultures where mistakes are not tolerated in the private sector, which then obviously actually has a perverse impact by basically driving transparency underground. So because people don't want to admit to mistakes, it also gives rise to a culture of lack of accountability. So people will not want to take accountability for it. So I wouldn't necessarily say that. The private sector could say that that's always the case at all. I think it's about the culture that you create, and you almost, through leadership tone, you legitimise the fact as that actually making a mistake is okay, and actually it's a learning opportunity, and businesses can build on that. Mm-hmm. So I think I wouldn't say there's a distinction between private and public sector in that regard.
Well, can I come back on that?
Absolutely.
I talked about lean principles and lean cultures, and I do think it is being adopted almost wholesale in our sector. And one of the best things about it, from a company culture point of view, is the close enough is good enough and go. So we regularly talk about if the decision feels like it's 80% right, go, and then make it better. And this iterative loop where you go and then go, okay, we're close, but that still needs to be fixed. Now change that, and that's how. When you talk about Lean Six Sigma, you're approaching your 98.666%. It's the steps and steps and steps to get there. I think that's a hugely healthy part of our sectors. And companies adopted Lean principles to survive. And now especially those that are really on board with it, get the benefit of that. But the fail fast, learn quick, is that's that 80%. Close enough is good enough, let's go. That might be a challenge for you.
Yeah, we could explore that probably further. I mean, presumably, I mean, some decisions, even within business, therefore, you're 80% sure you make the decision, and then you can perhaps improve on it as you go along, although the other risk is that it's just been totally the wrong decision and you have to start again.
80% is a big... So 80% says you're in the right ballpark, and the big challenge that companies make is any company who thinks that we'll wait until that decision's perfect, or our beliefs in it, or our analysis of it is perfect, they're the ones who are staring at their belly buttons. Mm-hmm. So 80% says that you're on the right track, you have the right direction, but you may have to tweak the model. Mm-hmm. But that's time to go. And that's, I think, the thing that brings the pace and rapidness back into things.
So from what you can see of the public sector, we probably don't do that.
Well, as I say, I wouldn't pretend to know you well enough to know that 80% is good enough for you. There are different scrutinies, there are different cultural impacts on your ability to do that. But yeah, I would say it's the gold standard. If government could find a way to work and act in that way, I think it would work like the best of private sector.
Okay. Mr. Begg?
Yeah, I'd come back a couple of points. I think one is speed of decision-making can be important depending on the situation you're in. Quick decisions might not necessarily always be the right decisions. But a couple of observations in my dealings with civil service over many years. I think one is there is a culture of wanting to try and reach 100%. So there is this point at which there's a lot of time and effort applied to try and close down every single potential risk and concern about a decision. So the 80-20 mindset, in my experience, is an uncomfortable one. And you can see that through, because I've had exposure to a number of reviews over the last few years in particular that are undertaken, where you will end up with, you could end up with 60 or 70 or 80 different findings that come out of review, when the reality is when you look through them, probably half a dozen will deliver 80% of what you're looking for. But there's this desire to have a long tail of actions that actually aren't really going to really materially change the outcome. So as an observation, there isn't a mindset or a culture of trying to say, OK, we've done the review, we're now just going to focus on delivering on these three or four things. And actually, the rest of them are important, but they're not that important. So, I'm involved in various review groups, skills action, so the NSET, for example, I'm on the skills programme board. You know, if you look at that, there was like 76 findings. You can't deliver 76 findings. You know, you can deliver four. Just leave the other 72. You know, just so really try and prioritise.
That's really interesting. I'll leave it at that, Convener.
Yeah, interesting stuff. Daniel, to be followed by Ross.
Yeah, I mean, I've been finding the discussion really fascinating. And I actually think, to Paul Sheeran's points, I think the twin kind of concepts of Lean, of both the Six Sigma, but actually also the Kaizen principles of actually ensuring that everyone's involved with the improvement is actually something that could, I think, the public sector could really benefit from. I was just wondering, just continue with the sort of the compare and contrast, and I take the points about rapidity, and also on the other hand, in terms of the difference in the private sector being, or successful private sector, and I think that's an important distinction. Not everything in the private sector is good. About strategic alignment. I wonder if there's also an issue, and I'd wonder if you would agree with this, about overemphasis on policy. So in business, successful businesses, actually kind of the operations and that the delivery will tend to actually be much more important than the kind of the, or at least have equal weight to that you know, the idea origination. Do you think that's an issue in terms of kind of government decision making, that kind of overemphasis of policy and a lack of depth of understanding and kind of delivery and managing that side of things? Don't know if
I'll have a go first. I do think that comes back to a little bit that point I made earlier about distilling the message down. So I would say if in industry, our equivalent of policy is strategy, then a successful strategy is one where you stop someone anywhere in your organisation and say, could you tell me in two sentences what the strategy for our company is? And they know what it is. And to do that, the way you explain and present has to be extreme. You need to spend so much more time clarifying and distilling it down to the essence. And that takes real work and effort and leadership. If you can say that about policy from a government point of view, well done. From what I see, policy, it's people like us who take the time to understand that, and it's hard work. It's harder work. And you look at that difference again between industry are aiming to get to a point where everyone in their organisation, as far as possible, understands and can repeat what the key strategy of the company is.
Sandy.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with Paul on that point. I mean, I think one of the best things we ever did at Standard Life was we had two sheets of paper. One was our financial strategy on a page, another one was our non-financial strategy on a page, and it was literally two pieces of paper. And it told our, 10,000 employees across the world how we were performing. And actually become so rooted inside the organisation, you could speak to anyone at any place in the world, and they would be able to tell you how the company was performing. And it was literally two pieces of paper. So this idea of understanding the audience and actually trying to make it relatable, so that people do understand their role. So, and that was part of the cascade, which was, do you understand that your role is actually contributing to whatever, whether it's financial or non-financial performance of the organisation. So, and I think that's important, because then people are likely to then be able to relate to it and then feel as though what they're doing and then implement effectively. So I think that the other thing I would add, Daniel, and this is, again, this is an observation, is at times you get a sense of government there's some contradiction between policies or actually there is too much going on. And therefore, if you've got too much going on, then how can you effectively embed it and deliver it? Because there's not the bandwidth inside the organisation to do it effectively. So that prioritisation process, I'm not sure how it happens, but it always feels as though that there's a very broad base of policy work that then presents some of the embedding and execution challenges.
So again, one of my reflections, we've heard a lot about how there is a sort of a lack of consistency both around policy making between portfolios and indeed implementation, probably even more so. And the explanation is, well, the things that government does are so different that you can't have a an identical approach. Now, I think my pushback on that is, if I sort of think about some of the large organisations I've come into contact, they may have different at a technical level different approaches, but they're typically based on common approaches, so that somebody from one part of the business would recognise in broad terms that, do you think that is a lesson from business that the government can, in terms of having, yes, different detailed implementation, but very strong core principles in terms of both policy design and implementation?
I would say this. There are organisations, huge, large global organisations, who will have a consistent change in delivery model applied across the globe. So I don't think the size, complexity of the organisation applies. I think it's to your point, is there are certain aspects of change in delivery that can be consistent. The technical element of it will be different. It's the same in the private sector. You could be dealing in a different part of the world with different consumers and a different product, etc. But the reality is that the elements of that change in delivery methodology are consistent. So therefore, if you're working in one part of the business, you can relate to what's happening in another part of the business. You might not understand it technically, but you understand how it's going to be delivered. Whether it's Kaizen, whether it's Six Sigma, etc. There are lots of different methodologies, but usually an organisation will choose to adopt a methodology that works for them.
Would you agree with that, Mr. Sheehan?
I don't think I've really got anything to add to what Sandy said. I think you summed it up really well.
One final question here. I mean, one of the interesting points is whether or not we've got consistent understanding of roles through the Scottish government. So, coming from my previous corporate life, we were obsessed with RACI models, which was about responsibility, accountable, consulted and informed. And I think sometimes there's a blurring of those distinctions, particularly actually zeroing in. If I look what is understood by a programme board within the Scottish government, I think we've got actually a number of different things going on, some of which look like programme boards, as I would understand them, which are really about integrating different areas of delivery, and you'll see just sort of government officials. But other programme boards seem to be more like kind of consultation boards, because they've got a lot of external bodies. And both of those are actually really important functions, but they're different. A programme board should be very much internal and managing risk across different projects. I think external consultation is absolutely engaging with some of those things. Do you think there's potentially an issue with the Scottish Government mixing metaphors and having clarity about the different strata of decision and where integration sits and where external consultation sits? Especially, Sandy, given some of your experience in terms of some of these things.
Yes, I think so. I sit on some of the consultation or advisory boards. So you do wonder where it sits within the broader governance structure of the delivery of something. So if you're there to, and having that clear terms of reference, I think is important, and sometimes it's clearer than others. But I think understanding how all that connects together, I think, is quite important. It goes back to my point about having a consistent methodology that underpins that, and language, to your point, Daniel. I think that, you know, language is very, very important, so people do understand that distinction. But I think that the whole RACI model, et cetera, and what you talk about, roles and responsibilities, that for me is just a subset of a broader point, which is about understanding how the organisation is designed and how it's supposed to operate, and how it's supposed to operate effectively and efficiently. And that picks up organisation design, it picks up structures, it picks up capabilities, you know, which we've not really touched on, but does the organisation actually have the capabilities to execute what it's going to execute? So for me, that's broader of a subset of a broader piece around organisation design and how the organisation is supposed to set itself up for success.
A tricky one for me to answer. I'm not on a number of such boards. I'm on the programme board for Making Scotland's Future. And I suppose the comment I would say is, the way that's structured, there is a quite a heavy contingent from public sector and from civil servants that are there, but there's also representation from industry. And the way it's run, if we weren't there, if industry weren't there, then there would need to be some other mechanism, because otherwise you'd be operating in a bubble and you wouldn't be having the voices that, you know, from with a different perspective and hopefully can act as critical friends. So I suppose I listen to that and think, from an efficiency point of view, now you're going to have to run two sets of meetings. You have to run one where you're in the public sector only, and then another one where you're consulting. What would we do in industry? We'd do one meeting.
I mean, is it a programme board as you'd recognise it, though, or is it more of a sort of a round table discussion forum?
I haven't been on any other programme boards. I'm on other boards. Well,
the one that you do sit on?
The one I do. We definitely have space and time for scrutiny and to act as a critical friend, which, yeah, I think is useful.
Okay. Can I just ask one final follow-up question? I think the points that were discussed about the generalism versus specialism are interesting to me. I wonder if there's I'd just like to sort of put the question that I put to the previous panel. Is there a question about how you bring about generalism, in that it's not something necessarily you should be starting people off on a career, that you need the people need a grounding in a specialism before you broaden them out into a generalism? And is that potentially an issue if the civil service is trying to create generalists from the moment they arrive in the civil service?
I think for me, I've always used the kind of T principle, which is breadth and depth, and I think the most effective leaders will have both. And depending on what they're in, then they might have more breadth at certain points, but they'll always have a depth, usually a profession or something that they've got a technical expertise in that they can then transfer. So I don't think it's a case of saying generalist versus technical. Actually, I think that the further you go up the organisation, then, you know, there's a lot of research around this, is that the further you go up into broader leadership roles, then that balance between breadth and technical expertise changes. And I think just trying to understand that at different levels in the civil service, I think is important, because quite often people are promoted because of their technical expertise, but actually you do get to a point in your career where actually leadership becomes more important than your technical expertise.
Pretty much the same. I do think when I look at what I think good leadership looks like, I think the ability to port from something to another thing very quickly is the bit that always impresses me. But then what they have is that breadth and depth, and I do, I like the T analogy, is their ability to literally fall like they're falling in a parachute to get down to the level of detail they need to, and then get right back up to the top again. Yeah. That always impresses me when I see that in leadership. They skirt along the top, they stay broad, and then they dive really quickly, get to the nub, get back out, because that's not their place to be.
Yeah. Very helpful. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ross, before by Douglas.
Thanks, Convener. I'm subbing on Bureau today and I'm going to have to leave in less than 5 minutes. I don't want to be rude to colleagues and get up and leave while they're answering my own question, so I'm happy to just move on to another colleague if that's easiest.
Okay, Douglas.
Thank you, Convener. I want to go back to skills, because I think you said that there was an issue there. And it's really just to try and work out, you know, what is going wrong and what can the government learn and put in place going forward to try and make things better. And it's not really particularly around the skills agenda. I asked this. It's about the governance and decision making of government to try and improve the situation.
Sandy,
okay.
Do you want to?
On you. On you. It's quite difficult just to answer that narrow question without a bit of context. So I think, and I called this out in the Young Persons Guarantee report, is I think it's really important for our government to be really clear about what are the industries that are going to be part of the future economy over the next 5-10 years. Because that clarity of direction, it goes back to the earlier point about strategy. If you've got that strategy, then you can then make decisions. That's your point about how do you then make decisions whereby each component of the skills system, and I include education and all of that, then aligns behind that. Because at the moment, for me, it's a big supply and demand equation. And at the moment, the demand and the supply side are out of line. So the decisions for me need to be taken around how do you better align those two. So industry needs to be clearer about what it needs, particularly those industries that are going to be growing. And like, if you take the whole environment, climate, for example, what are the type of jobs that we're going to need in industry over the next 5-10 years? And that is at best is going to be an 80-20, right? So it's going to change, but you need to have a direction of travel. How do you then get the supply side to align behind that? Colleges, universities, secondary schools, etc. And the question I always, the test I always apply, did through the Young Persons Guarantee, was if I'm a 15-year-old in school and I'm interested in a career in manufacturing or engineering or renewables, how do I go from where I am to put myself in a position for that at some point in the future, whether that involves college or university or you know, apprenticeship straight into a company? At the moment, we've got this big disconnect. And that's why industry gets frustrated, because there isn't a pipeline of people who are coming into the industry with having the knowledge and taking the right decisions around the pathways into that industry. So that's kind of what I would say. So at the moment, that's I think the decisions need to be taken around that.
And is that because government are just focused on short-term goals as opposed to looking at longer-term, and you know, it could be like 10, 15 years before you have, I guess, children coming through education and then into industry?
I'm not taking industry out of this, Douglas. I would say that there is decisions that need to be made within government around some of those, how to reorientate the system. But I think I think engineering do it well. I think financial services do it. We're trying to make efforts to do this better. But I think a lot of other sectors need to be clearer about what their need is, looking out over the next 3-5+ years. And I don't think enough of them try and articulate the demand side well enough. So there's work needs to be done on both sides.
Mm-hmm. So is that maybe government working closer with industry to work out what the needs are and consulting with them more, as opposed to maybe general consultation?
Yes, correct.
Yeah. But I guess government would, to give them credit, might say, well, you know, we're working with organisations like Skills Development Scotland. They should be doing that. Would that not be correct, or...?
I think we've got all the components of the system that's just not aligned at the moment, and I think it lacks that clarity around saying here are the industries that we're really going to double down on over the next 5-10 years that actually we need the skills system and education system to align behind. And if you look, so I'm trying not to be overly critical, Scott, because I actually do think we've got some good examples of where it can work, and I think we've got all the components to make it work better. But if you look at other countries, some of them in Europe, some of them in the Far East, they've got that really, really tight alignment, and so therefore the industries that are really important to the future economy can look at education and skills, and they can see that a lot of that activity and that content is actually aligned with what they're going to be needing. And I think we need to tighten that up, whether it's SDS, whether it's secondary schools, colleges, universities. But as I say, employers need to do more as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. I'm just trying to think how we would fit that into a report going forward, Convener. But okay. Thank you. Oh, sorry, Paul, did you want to come in?
So I'd like to illustrate the point, because I think it goes back to the example that I gave and the evidence we submitted beforehand. So Sandy's point about tying what we do and our actions in the short, medium and long term to the economy for Scotland, I think, is absolutely key in this respect. So we start the situation where we are just now. So our engineering manufacturing sector are just off the back of 8 quarters of successive growth in output and orders. With that have come the same 8 successive quarters of lack of people, lack of skills. Our big wish for industry has been that our companies, particularly our SMEs, will step up to the plate and provide the demand signal, which will pull through, particularly in work-based learning, where we have the majority of our shortages. And we face a future where the opportunity for Scotland is off the scale through the 4 pillars of offshore wind, the associated hydrogen generation that goes with that, decarbonising transport and decarbonising heat. And all of them, our biggest shortage is in work-based learning, apprentice-based skills. Our situation just now is that there are companies who have approached their local training groups and their local colleges to be told, I'm sorry, there is no budget for more apprentices. So we have a situation where the majority of the work that we will actually have to have hands on is arriving in the 4 or 5 year time frame. You start an apprentice today, this year, they will become useful to you in 3, 4, 5 years time. And we are saying that we cannot fund those places. As a country, we spend 3% of our entire skills budget on work-based learning, which is, in my opinion, pitiful. And it goes back to Sandy's point about our priority for the kind of training which will deliver high-quality, well-paid, fair work jobs. We're spending only 3%. And the answer seems to be to bat the ball back to Skills Development Scotland and say, it's your budget, you go and find it. Again, from industry's point of view, Skills Development Scotland had their budget cut by £10 million this year, which impacted directly on their ability to deliver apprentices, in an overall growth in the skills budget for Scotland. So the frustration from industry, from a decision point of view, is there is a huge opportunity for well-paid, high-quality, fair work jobs, but we need to act on it now. And we cannot even seem to move at the pace to say we need to change our priorities. Because we understand there are no magic money trees. We can't just dream money up out of nowhere. But in a situation, go back to what does business do? You make some harder choices. Where are the links to the economic opportunities for Scotland that need to be given priority? And yes, that will mean that somebody will lose out. But if we do not do that, then the opportunities, those 4 pillars, will sail past us and we will not realise the opportunity for Scotland. So our frustration is, faced with that admittedly slightly blinkered view of the world, we could not understand how you would sit in any company, so Scotland PLC, and say this is not something where we need to act and change tack now and change priorities.
If I had leader of Scotland PLC in today, so what advice would you give him to? He would probably say, well, I would have to defund something else to do that. So
absolutely.
What would your advice be on that?
So I'm not going to go to that. Because that's the same as people who have said to me when I was sitting in a leader position, that is your job, Paul. You carry the leadership role, but you know, and I do know, that you have to act today or else you lose that opportunity. So I'm not going to say who should lose out in that. And that'll be a hard decision, no doubt. That's life for all of us. Mm-hmm. A hard decision to be made.
What you would say, it's for the long-term benefit of the Scotland PLC in the end.
It's always good to put numbers. So sitting within Scotland, the first 17 projects alone, and I believe we're up to 20 now, plus the recently announced INTOG ones, the innovation in Target Oil and Gas, the first 17 projects alone carry a committed spend in the supply chain development statement of £25.8 billion spent in Scotland. That is the target that was signed up for by those companies when they put their bid in. £12.8 billion of that is manufacturing in Scotland. We don't have enough people today. If we don't do something which delivers the skills which will take up that opportunity, and the economic benefit will sail past. Mm-hmm. If someone else can make an argument that trumps that, fair enough. I don't believe that's the case. And then there's the wider issue of all of that is simply us doing our part in the bigger challenge against the climate emergency.
And final question, is it lack of people or lack of skills then?
So there are no shortage of people who want to come and do apprenticeships.
Okay.
Our average, we believe, is around 50 applications for every one place. Now, back to a point that earlier was made, the balance of any measure of diversity in that isn't where we would like it to be. But to Rebecca's point, it's something that's changing a little too slowly, but there's lots of work being done in that area. So whilst I would agree, you know, the balance isn't great, there is no lack of demand. But you have a situation now where a company says, OK, I'm going to do an apprenticeship or more apprenticeships. And they've come forward and said, I'm ready to do it, let's go. And right now, some of them are being told, I'm sorry, there's no budget.
OK.
And that's the bit which we industry find just unacceptable.
Right. OK. Thank you. Thanks, Commissioner.
Being here, right, so we're trying to talk about how to improve government decision making. So I'm just think that's more about the choice of decisions, I think. But I think it's points that have been extremely well made by Paul, and it was a good question actually by Douglas. It's an issue which I have raised with the previous First Minister at the Conveners Committee, as well as many other forum and including the Chamber. So I'm certainly on board with what's being said. So I think one of the things, though, to follow on from that and just to kind of finish off really, is how can decision making improve, decision making relationships with ministers be improved? So we've heard about how the private sector takes decisions. Before that we had a session about public sector and how we can perhaps improve decision making. So how can this interaction be improved? Whoever wants to go first.
I think I mean, this is very much from the outside kind of looking in terms of my experience. I think the interaction between ministers and civil servants, I think for me, I mean, I'd obviously joined in the last 10 minutes. I mean, there's no doubt that you've got a political cycle. You know, it could be 5 years, could be less. Ministers can be moved. It is about having an agenda that is, wherever possible, is not wholly reliant just simply on that minister, I would suggest, because I think that that then allows people, gives people the confidence to make those decisions. So wherever possible, almost have that direction of travel as being set, regardless of the minister. And that might be an easy thing to say, harder to bring about in practice. But I think that's the only way you get that longer term focus on delivery and implementation and then impact on the back of that. I think that there needs to be, another point I would make is, which I've kind of touched on earlier, is about making sure there's that diversity of thought. That comes from a whole variety of different perspectives. But I think ensuring that the quality of decision that's made has gathered as much of that diversity of thought as possible. Through whichever forum you choose to do it. But I think making sure that that relationship between minister and the broader civil service and any other consultation group recognises that diversity of thought, and so that ministers are getting all the information, the transparency as I said earlier, in order to help them make those decisions.
I think that's an important point you made, because, I mean, obviously, where I think the Scottish Government has done better relative to the UK Government has been where there's been consistency of policy, whereby the private sector knows that this is going to be the policy. As in tablets of stone as it can be in politics, and therefore they can make long-term investment decisions, where the Scottish Government has not done as well relative to Westminster, is probably where there has been this kind of turmoil and perhaps change of direction in policy. So I think that's an important point. Paul?
So I really agree with what Sandy said, the points that I would add to it. I come back to this rapidity of decision making. So I do think that consideration of whether something needs to be rapid now or considered is one that I think would improve that. I think we all understand that, we would say that we get good access to forums where we can give our input. We, you know, both, you know, ministerial connection and also to civil servants. The decisions are the decisions. Some will like, some will not. I don't think that's the issue. I want to come back to it because I did. Apologies if I went off track on my skills soapbox, which is usual for me. But at the bottom of it, I think, is this is, I think the important part in that is it's not that we don't like the decision, it's we don't like the lack of decision, because from industry's point of view, that's just kicking the can down the road. So, and then that's one where that lack of, oh, we're in a situation where a decision needs to be much more rapid. That for me would be an example of an improved decision-making process.
Okay, so indecisiveness is obviously a concern in some instances. Okay, I'm going to wind up the session now, just by giving the opportunity to our witnesses to make any final points, if there's any issue we feel we haven't touched on or you wish to emphasise at this point. Sandy?
No, I'm fine, thank you.
You okay? Paul, anything you want to say?
Thanks for inviting me today. I must admit, when
I came along, I thought, I'm not sure how useful the conversation could be. Thanks for the questions, because I think they've allowed us to make it specific to particularly the sector that we know. So thanks for that.
Okay, thank you, Rebecca. Last word with you, if you want to make.
Nothing, just thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much. So, again, I want to thank our witnesses for coming along today. It's been very helpful and given us another dimension to the inquiry that we're undertaking. So we'll continue taking evidence on effective Scottish Government decision-making at our future meetings. That concludes the public part of today's meeting. The next item on our agenda will be a discussion in private with regard to our work programme, so I'll just like to call a 2-minute break to enable our witnesses and official report to leave. Thank you. Thanks.